Good morning. Good to see everybody this morning. Welcome on this holiday, Labor Day weekend, and welcome to Pine Valley Methodist Church. And good to see everyone. A couple of announcements that we have. Please read all the things that are going on in the bulletin. We have all kinds of kickoffs that are happening. Wednesday night supper starts back this Wednesday night. Can somebody say amen? Amen. 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 And we are having, and so when you pass the pew pad down, please put how many is going to be there. That will help us to plan. We always plan for more, but that will help us to plan. But also, we will have no classes, but we will have dinner together, and the classes will start the next week. All of those classes are listed. Check out the classes from, we've got everything from daytime classes and the nighttime classes. Also, Axis, our college age and young adult ministry, we'll eat dinner with the regular Wednesday night supper crew this week. And then we're going to meet and just hang out a little bit after all of that is over. So probably about 7:15 we'll be hanging out, or 7 o'clock we'll be hanging out. So anyway, looking forward to that. But I'll just check out all of these. We've got a couple of inserts and with the discipleship things, all ages. We've got on Wednesday nights, we got everything from children's ministry, youth ministry, and small groups. And then, of course, all of our adult classes as well. Next Sunday afternoon starts back all of our youth and children's choirs and Ignite and everything. So that will start next Sunday afternoon. And all the information is right there in the bulletin. So don't forget about that. Operation Christmas Child is September's mission of the month, and so check out all the things in there and ways that you can support that, as we are going to be collecting and doing Christmas shoe boxes for Operation Christmas Child this year. Let us worship the Lord.
Together and pray together our morning prayer that is on the screens. Sovereign God, We know the plans you have for us. As we worship today, help us to trust you and be open to the places and people that you will use to bring your plans to fruition in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'd like to invite you to remain standing as we sing together our opening song. It's just simply called Jesus Saves. Let's sing it together.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saved, Jesus saved. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saved, Jesus saved. Tell the news to every land. Life is needs across the way. Onward is the Lord's command. Jesus saved, Jesus saved.
And let us affirm our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and stood at the right hand of God. Father Almighty, from thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Before you seat, take a moment and share the love of Christ with somebody this morning. Wish somebody a good morning.
Good morning. It's so wonderful to be here and worship with you, and it's a joy to see you greet each other with the peace of Christ. If you are a first-time guest at Pine Valley, welcome. We ask that you let us know because we have a little goodie bag we'd like to gift you as you leave worship. Don't be afraid. We're not going to try to sell you anything or Yeah, anyway, we have this little connect card, and we ask that if you will, just give us a little bit of information about yourself so we can just reach out to you, say hello, get to know you a little bit better. You can fill that out and drop it in the offering box, which are those white boxes at the exits. We'd love to just say hello to you. If you are sitting at the end of a row, there is a blue fellowship pad. We ask that if you will, complete that and pass it down, and we are getting ready for our Wednesday night suppers. Y'all supposed to say amen?
Amen.
For people like me, well, I don't cook anyway. But that means you don't have to cook if you cook. So so we need to know if you're coming to Wednesday night. We'd like to get a little estimate of how many we can prepare for, but we always have room and God always supplies. It is a glorious day to be here in the house of the Lord. We welcome you to worship, and now we welcome our children for a time with Pastor Tim.
Good to see y'all this morning. Well, I've got something. It's my grandson's little Bronco steering wheel. It goes on his little Bronco. And so I want y'all, let's make like we're driving a car, all right? And I got some sound effects on this one a little bit. So come on, let's make like we're driving a car. Ready? All right, let's pretend we're on one of those little go-karts, maybe at Jungle Rapids, and you know, now we got to go let's all go this way, ready? Now go that way, and now we're going straight and everything. Well, you know, when we're driving one of those little go-karts, and the adults that are driving have to do it with the road, but on those little go-karts, there's something that helps you know when to go right and left, when to go straight. And it's because the car is on, what's the car on? Something called a what? You know what it is? What are we driving it on? A track, that's right. We're driving it on a track. And that, you know, and that's how we know we're going the right way, because and the good thing about it on those go-karts, that track usually has some edges on both sides, some guardrails that help keep us on the track, right? And all. Well, you know, God's plans are like a track for us. And we want to follow God's plan. We want to be there and be a part of God's plan. And it's like staying on track. And you know what helps us stay on track? Coming to church, being at Sunday school or vacation Bible school and Wednesday night classes, those kind of things. And then also reading our Bible and praying. All of those are some things that will help us stay on God's track, all right? And so we want to do that with God's plan. Well, let's pray together. Lord, we thank you so much for these children. And Lord, help us, Lord, help them, even at a young age, stay on your track with your plans in a mighty and awesome way. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Y'all can, first grade and under, can follow Miss Sarah to Children's Church.
Through prayer, we invite you on that same connect card. On the back of it is a place where you can write prayer requests. You can also write your praises there too, and then drop those in the offering box, and they'll be given to our prayer ministry team. This morning, we want to express our Christian sympathies to Donna Richardson Kelly and family on the passing of her son, Christopher Parker, on August the 18th, as well as to Jimmy and Lynn Shuffler's son-in-law, his mom, Suzanne Moody, passed away on August 26th, and she is going to have a celebration of life on September 8th. The flowers on the altar, you see these, there's two of them this morning. They're given to the glory of God with love in memory of Mary Rabin by Bill Rabin. and then given to the glory of God in honor of Ed and Iris Boone's 55th wedding anniversary. So congratulations. And they're sitting right back there. The flowers that are in the narthex are given in adoration to our Lord and sincere thanks to the pastor's staff and congregation of Pine Valley Methodist Church by Jerry Ganey, Tracy Smith, and family. And on behalf of the pastors and staff and our congregation, we thank them for that. At this time, let's center our hearts and go to the Lord in prayer. Holy and loving God, what an honor and a privilege it is to be in your house and to call on the name of Jesus. We are here, Lord, to worship you. So please continue to bless us as we sing your songs and praise you, Lord. As we come to you in prayer, not only for needs, but in thanksgiving of what you have done in our lives. And thanking you in advance for what you're going to do, Lord. We thank you for miracles that we are seeing happen, Lord. For all the stones that are being placed in the jars. And even the miracles that we don't even know about, Lord. Ones we may not be able to see yet, but you're working on them, Lord. And we thank you for always being there. And Lord, we come to you this morning. And we do have needs, we have concerns, we have things that just weigh us down, and at times it just seems so heavy. But you didn't create us to carry them all alone, Lord. You said to cast our cares to you, Lord, to give them to you. So right now, Lord, we want to honor that and lift out loud names and concerns that are on our hearts. Father, you hear your children praying. We pray with confidence and assurance that you hear every request, every praise, Lord. No matter how small or large, Lord, we lift up our family and friends who are in the hospital or awaiting test results, or maybe the test results were not the way we were thinking, Lord. We just ask for your healing hand. We thank you for medical personnel and ask that you continue to use them as instruments of your healing, Lord. We pray for reconciliation, for recovery, Lord. Lord, help us to be the children you have called us to be. Loving you and loving our neighbors as ourselves, Lord. And Lord, we pray for peace in our world, peace in all of those dark places, Lord. Let your light shine. And Lord, as we sing at Christmas, let there be peace on earth. Help us to not just sing it at Christmas, but every day. Let peace begin with us. Help us, Lord, to love. And thank you for this opportunity to worship. We ask you to bless Pastor Tim as he brings your word, Lord. May we hear it and receive it and respond. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And now together as your beloved children, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now as we go into our time of worship by giving God his tithes and our offerings, we thank you for partnering in ministry with us here at Pine Valley. You can drop your offering in the offering box, give online at pvmc.life or through the Church Center app. But with a grateful heart, let us give God his tithes and our offerings.
Father. Lord, we come before you today with our humble tithes and offerings, Lord. Use them to glorify your name and spread it throughout this world as your kingdom comes on earth. We just thank and give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Got a couple little praise choruses we're going to sing together. Have a little fun with these. We got to shake off those heavy bands and lift up those holy hands in this first one. You'll figure it out. Let's sing together.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let all God's people praise the Lord.
Shake them off now.
Shake off those heavy bands. Lift up those holy hands. Let all God's people praise the Lord.
Let's do that again.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let all God's people praise the Lord.
Off now.
Shake off those heavy bands. Lift up those holy hands. Let all God's people praise the Lord.
We serve a mighty God.
What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Let all God's people.
Let all God's people praise the Lord.
Shake off those heavy bands.
Shake off those heavy bands. Lift up those holy hands. Let all God's people praise the Lord.
One more time. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let all God's people praise the Lord. Shake off those heavy bands. Lift up those holy hands. Let all God's people praise the Lord.
Let's praise God for all the music this morning. Praise God. If you have your Bible, turn with me to the book of Exodus. The book of Exodus, chapter 2. And we're going to be reading verses 1 through 10. The book of Exodus, chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Let us stand this morning for God's word. And a man of the house of Levi went and took as wife a daughter of Levi. So the woman conceived and bore a son. And when she saw that he was a beautiful child, she hid him 3 months. But when she could no longer hide him, she took an ark of bulrushes for him, dabbed it with asphalt and pitch, put the child in it, and laid it in the reeds by the river's bank. And his sister stood afar off to know what would be done to him. Then the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river. and her maidens walked along the riverside. And when they saw the ark of the reeds, she sent her maid to get it. And when she opened it, she saw the child, and behold, and the baby wept. And so she had compassion on him and said, "This is one of the Hebrews' children." Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and call a nurse for you from the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for you?" And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Go." So the maiden went and called the child's mother. Then Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child away and nurse him for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed him, and the child grew. And she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. So she called his name Moses, saying, "Because I drew him out of the water." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word and for the inspiration of it. May it speak to our hearts and our lives today. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, we are continuing our series called Pharaoh, Pharaoh, and it's about Moses and the Exodus story. And we got started last week. Remember, we talked about how you really have to go to the end of Genesis to where Joseph and his descendants and all the Hebrew people had come to Egypt because of that famine that was in the land. And then they, after some generations later, we find that there is a new Pharaoh, and we talked about those new pharaohs that come up, and those can be situations in our lives that come up, and all of a sudden things are not as they should be or as we thought they would be, and these new pharaohs definitely throw things into our lives, and the enemy uses those pharaohs to enslave us, and he uses those pharaohs to they're always protecting their power over us. And so we talked about our strategies for that is to see that salvation is about being set free, and our salvation story is about being set free to whatever Pharaoh we have in our life. And then also we talked about how God's presence is always more than that Pharaoh's power. God's presence brings more than the Pharaoh's power, and we see over and over in the Exodus story how God's presence is there and moving. And so that's kind of going to continue in some ways as we talk about and get started in the Exodus story. Now, you remember, to protect Pharaoh's power, he put out a decree that all of the male children would be killed. He said, if there's male children that are born, male babies that are born, I want them gone. He did not want any other future soldiers for Israel to be there. And so he puts this out, but Moses is born, and his mother hides him for the first 3 months. And she then, look at verse 3. "But when she could no longer hide him, she took an ark of bulrushes for him, dabbed it with asphalt and pitch, and put the child in it, and laid it in the reeds by the river's bank." And so Moses' mother, to spare his life, she takes and builds this basket with pitch and asphalt so that the water couldn't get in, and with reeds, and she places them there by the riverside with the hopes of Moses being found and protected in some way. And that's exactly what happens. The Exodus story begins with a baby in a basket. Isn't it interesting that our salvation story begins with a baby? Not a baby in a basket, but a baby in a manger. Isn't it interesting that in the Exodus salvation story, it's a baby in the basket and it's in Egypt, and in our salvation story, it's a baby in the manger and they escape to Egypt? You just can't make this stuff up. Amen. This morning we are going to look at this baby in the basket and how we see that God's plan can be unfolding in those ways, even when it starts with a baby in a basket. So what can this baby in the basket teach us this morning? Number one is this: it teaches us that God is working a plan even when we don't see it. Even when we don't see it, God is working a plan. Think about the Hebrew people. They were not seeing any light at the end of the tunnel. They were not seeing any way. Pharaoh had said, okay, not only am I going to enslave you, but I'm also going to start killing all of your male children, all of your male babies. Look at Exodus chapter 2, verse 5 and 6, though. Then the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe in the river, and her maidens walked along the riverside, and when she saw the ark among the reeds, she sent her maid to get it. And when she opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the baby wept. So she had compassion on him and said, "This is one of the Hebrew children." All male baby Hebrew children were supposed to be killed, but she puts Moses' mom places this baby in the ark, and lo and behold, of all people that find it, it's Pharaoh's daughter. There was a plan unfolding that they just couldn't see, that they didn't know. And aren't we like this sometimes? We are usually, instead of saying, okay, God, I know you're working here. I don't know what it is. I know you're working here. But aren't we the ones that often just start with, why is this happening? Why is this happening to me? I imagine the Hebrew people were thinking that. You know, they were probably thinking about Abraham's promise and that covenant that was made that God said. You know, they're probably thinking, whatever happened to those, I will bless those that bless you and I will curse those that curse you. The Hebrew people were probably thinking, hey, Lord, if there's any kind of cursing going on right now, they're doing it to us. You know, where are you at? And see, I think many times, just like that, we're the very same way. Why is this happening to us? What about you being with us? What about all of this? And what I think we should see here, we may not see his plan. And maybe we shouldn't even be seeking his plan. But what we should be seeking is him. We need to be seeking God. When we're seeking God, then his plan begins to unfold. I love Jeremiah 29:11. I love that verse. And it's on a lot of memes. It's on a lot of license plates. And you may know that verse by heart. I know a lot of people, that's their life verse. And you remember Jeremiah gave this verse whenever he had to come and tell them, hey, don't be worrying about these 2 years, Haliel that told you that you were going to be in exile for 2 years. Instead, you're going to be in exile for 70 years. And can you imagine hearing that news? He says, you better go ahead and start building some houses. You better start go ahead and planting some gardens. You're going to be here for a while. But then he says these words, "But for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for your good and not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. And in those days when you pray, I will listen. If you look for me wholeheartedly, you will find me." Now, we oftentimes quote that Jeremiah 11, but we forget that that only happens when we do Jeremiah 12 and 13. Yes, he's got plans for us. They are good plans that he has for us. They are with a future and a hope. But he says, don't be seeking those plans. He says, in those days when you pray, I will listen. And if you look for me wholeheartedly, you will find me. In other words, don't just seek the plans, seek me. That's what he's telling us. That's what he wants us to understand. Because God's plans are at work even when we don't see it. There's a story told about Socrates, that great philosopher. And this man came to him very kind of flippantly and said, hey, I'm seeking wisdom. And Socrates said, well, come with me down to one of these pools. And they came down to one of the pools and he got in the water and he said, now, what is it that you seek? He said, I'm seeking wisdom. Socrates took the man and pushed him under one time. He said, what is it that you're seeking? He said, I'm seeking wisdom. Socrates took him under and held him under for about 30 seconds and let him back up. And the guy said, now what are you seeking? He said, I'm seeking wisdom. And he held him under this next time for about a minute and then lets him up. And he says, what are you seeking? He said, right now I'm seeking air. And Socrates said this, if you start seeking wisdom as hard as you are seeking air, then that's when you will find wisdom. And folks, I believe that if we will start seeking the Lord as hard as we are seeking air, as hard as we are seeking those other things, more than we're seeking His plan, let's seek Him. Amen? Number two is this: not only does God's plan work, is God working a plan even when we don't see it, but also God's plan takes us to unlikely places. God's plan takes us to unlikely places. Now, that doesn't mean it takes you to bad places, but it takes you to places that you don't realize that you may be going, where He can be working and we don't see it. I mean, who would ever thought that God would unfold His plan through a baby in a basket? Well, of course, we can see that now because He unfolded His plan for us through a baby in a manger. But who would have ever thought that God would take Moses and raise him in Pharaoh's palace? But do you not think that gave Moses some insight on how all that thing would work for later, whenever he was going to be leading God's people out of Egypt? It gave him a connection with Pharaoh that he would have never had as a young Hebrew child being raised by Hebrew parents. But isn't it also awesome that God still was unfolding a plan even in that unlikely place? And that's what we need to understand, is God unfolds His plans in unlikely places. Listen, think about Jonah. God unfolded His plan for Jonah in a very unlikely place. It's called the belly of a whale. And you remember Jonah, he was told by God to go preach to Nineveh, and those Ninevites were so bad. Now, if you watched the VeggieTale version of this, they were fish slappers. They would slap people with fish, all right? That was, I reckon, the best way for kids. You could say, these people are mean, amen. But anyway, so they would just slap you with a fish. But the Ninevites were like really bad. Y'all can tell I had children and now grandchildren, amen. But anyway, but I remember from years ago, they were fish slappers. But anyway, but the Ninevites, they were terrible. And Jonah's like, I do not want to go preach to those Ninevites. I don't want to go do it. And he signs up and gets on a ship to go in the opposite way to Tarsus. And then on his way to Tarsus, of course, the storm comes and everything, and the pirates the shipmates that are on there end up throwing him overboard when they figure out that all this stuff is coming because Jonah's on their ship and he's disobeying God. And he ends up in the belly of a whale, or a great fish, the Bible says. And in those 3 days in that belly, Jonah's life is turned around. And he prays to the Lord, and he ends up on the shore. The whale spits him out, and he ends up on the shore, I'm sure, with some chunks and other stuff. Anyway, I shouldn't have brought that in there. But anyway, and he goes and preaches repentance to the Ninevites. And you know what they do? They repent. God's plan unfolded in a very unlikely place. A very unlikely place. In fact, I believe that's why Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6 says this: trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding, and in all ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path. You may be saying, God, why do I feel like I'm in Pharaoh's palace right now? Why do I feel like that I'm not going anywhere, that things aren't happening here? Maybe He has you in an unlikely place for a very special plan. I remember some years ago, whenever I was associate pastor up in Duplin County, and for 1 year, and I was about to start seminary, didn't know how I was going to do all that. Wanted to get married and all, and Tina really wanted to get married to me, and so I'll tell her I said that. But And how are we going to make all that happen and stuff? And I won't ever forget, they had told me that most likely there wouldn't be any church openings so that I could go pastor and then we'd be able to get married. And I was still living at home. She was living at home, at her home. And then I got this call from what was at that time the Goldsboro District Superintendent, who later became the pastor of this church, Reverend Jim Lee. And Jim Lee called me and said, Tim, there's something in the Wilmington district. He says, I don't even know exactly where it's at. I just know it's out there near White Lake somewhere. And I was like, oh, and he says, and it has a four-bedroom ranch-style house. Now, I didn't even know what ranch-style house was, but anyway, I figured, hey, I'll be able to get married, you know, and move her down eventually whenever we get married and stuff. And I said, I'll take it. I knew I wanted to preach. I knew I wanted to get married. And so, I mean, all that was, and he said, it's a long ways from Duke. I said, okay. And it was one of the farthest away appointments from Duke that anybody could get. I didn't care. And I went, and it was right out there in Bladen County. And I won't ever forget, we rode out there one day ahead of time. That's what all pastors do when you find out where you're going. You ride by. You have to do it in secret. Can't tell anybody or anything like that. But you just kind of, you do the ride by. And I remember riding by out there, and it was a gloomy day, and it was on Sunday, and so everything out there was closed. And man, we didn't know where we were going. And in fact, the Wilmington District Superintendent, Ruth Harper, some of y'all remember her, she was riding down. I rode down with her later to do the meeting, and she said, Tim, it's three churches. We're thinking about closing one of them. I was like, holy cow. And she said, last week they had two people there. And I was like, that's not a sermon, that's a conversation. You know what I'm saying? And she said, well, we're thinking about closing it, and you just having two churches. Well, I was 22 years old. There was no way I was going to make a decision to close a church. I said, let's see what the Lord can do. Folks, that church that almost closed became the largest church on that charge and went from five on a good Sunday. Amen. Amen. Went from five on a good Sunday to whenever we left, 135 on a regular basis. And I just want you to know, that was one of the most blessed places of ministry. God did some incredible things there. Those three churches sent at least five people into ministry during that time. I mean, there was was so incredible. And I think it also prepared me to come here. Because let me tell you something, those four E's that we used were the four E's that we were using there as well. And I believe it was all, God will place you in some unlikely places. Now, it kept my southern accent southern. I'll just go ahead and tell you. Amen. There won't no help in that anyway. But God places us in unlikely places. God's plan is. And then lastly is this. God's plan will use unlikely people in those unlikely places. When Pharaoh's daughter found Moses, she knew he was a Hebrew. Now, I love what happens here. She looks around, and there's Moses' sister. She didn't realize it, and there's Moses' sister over there, and she said, okay, I need a Hebrew woman to nurse him. And Moses' sister says, I know somebody. Moses' own mother gets to nurse him and take care of him for Pharaoh's daughter. Let me tell you something. God knows what he's doing. Amen? Amen. And they're able to end up keeping a relationship. God uses unlikely people in those unlikely places. And later when the baby was older, verse 10, his mother brought him back to Pharaoh's daughter, who adopted him as her own son, and the princes named him Moses, for she explained, I lifted him out of the water. That baby in the basket becomes the prince of Egypt. With God unfolding a master plan to later use him to deliver God's people out of Egypt. Listen, God used a simple carpenter and a young virgin maiden to be the earthly parents of Jesus Christ. Don't you remember there's even one verse there in the New Testament that says, what good could come out of Nazareth? Amen. There's probably people that say, what good could come out of Calypso? That's where I grew up, by the way. Might be still some people saying that when they hear me. Amen. But folks, this is salvation's story for us. And God's plan unfolds through unlikely people in unlikely places. I want to close with this. Now, I know that's always dangerous to hear a preacher say, because I've heard preachers say that, and then they close five different times. You know what I'm talking about? But anyway, no. I want to just close with this. I had a buddy in my former church, and I'm using this with permission. I actually talked to him yesterday or Friday, and all so that I could use his name. And a buddy, his name is Robbie. And Robbie ended up, great guy, very active, all, but there was some type of dispute over some land or something, and he ended up doing some time in jail, a self-defense kind of thing and all. Very, very heartbreaking in a lot of ways. But he did some time in jail. And I had not really kept up with him a whole lot after that and everything. But this was several years ago. And then about a year ago, I had this other friend named Henry that was here in town. And I ran into him. I hadn't seen him in a while, and I ran into him. And I said, "Hey, Henry, how you doing? I haven't seen you in a while." He said, "Well, it's kind of bad. I was in jail." And I said, "Oh, that is very bad." He said, "Well, it was sort of bad, but I tell you, it was actually the best thing that ever happened to me." I said, "Well, why? Tell me about it." And he said, while I was in jail in Bladen County, he said there was a guy in there that was in there over some type of self-defense thing or something, and he started a Sunday school or a Bible study in there. And he said, "Man, I gave my life to Christ." And he continued to talk about that guy. And then I asked him, I said, "What was his name?" And he said, "His name is Robbie." I was like, "Holy cow, I know him." And all. And Henry said, "Well, I'm about to move away from Wilmington because I need to get away from the crowd and the situation, drugs, all that kind of stuff that got me messed up in the first place and all." Anyway, I said, "Well, I will have to tell Robbie that I know you and what an impact he had on your life." He said, "Please do." And so it wasn't too long after that. One day I was at a gas station here in Wilmington, and I kind of forgot about it. And I was at a gas station here in Wilmington. In fact, this gal was blowing her horn at me like crazy as I was trying to get over. And I get over and pull up at one set of pumps, and she pulls up at the one right beside me. Now, you know, there was a part of me that wanted to get out and say, "Did that really help you get here any quicker or whatever?" But I was like, "No, I'm not going to say anything." So we got out just like we didn't even know each other, even though she was just like pumping the horn at me 2 seconds before that. But anyway, I turn around, and there's Robbie, which then I was thinking, thank the Lord I didn't act a fool. You know what I mean? But there was Robbie pumping gas, and I went over there, and I told him about Henry and what had happened. He broke out in tears, and he said, "Tim, I told the Lord, no matter where I would be, I'd praise him, and I'd do work for him." Amen, amen. Let me tell you something. In an unlikely place, through some unlikely people, I saw God unfolding a great plan for both Robbie and for Henry. And there's another one in the kingdom because of all of that. Amen? Amen. Amen. Listen, God has those kind of plans for us. And we just need to look for God's baby in the basket and trust in his plan in every way. And then as we seek him, those plans will begin to unfold. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your plans. We thank you, God, especially for your salvation plan. We thank you, Lord, that this holy meal is a reminder, a holy and living reminder of what you've done for us. And Lord, if there's any of us this morning that just need to seek you more or need to say yes to you, Lord, or to follow you, Lord, Lord, we pray that you will help get us on track. In Jesus' name, amen.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God,
we have confessed that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Hear the good news. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us, and that proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Amen. Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. God, amen. On a night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ, offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And God's people said, amen. If those that are serving would come at this time. Go ahead. I'll guide you. The table is ready. We invite you to come as the ushers guide you. You do not have to be a member here or a member anywhere. It is simply taking a step towards Christ and towards his love and grace. There are gluten-free and prepackaged. If you need one of those, you'll want to come to one of these stations, okay? There's three stations, follow the ushers, but if you need gluten-free or prepackaged, come to one of these stations. Come now. The table is ready.
sing our final hymn this day. God is so good.
God. Amen. Amen. Now may we go. May we go with the grace and the trust of knowing even the baby in the basket, God is still unfolding a wonderful plan in our life. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, God bless you. We love you. Amen. We hope that you have been blessed by today's broadcast of Pine Valley Methodist Church. We would love to have you come and visit us. All of our information is at our website at pvmc.life. Again, that's pvmc.life. God bless you. We love you. Have a great day.